Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of MGR Unplugged. This is your host, Manuel Gil del Real, and I'm here with David again. And guess what, David? We're in earnings season. This is our favorite time of the year, four times.
Yeah, I was going to say four times a year. It's not once
it's
a year.
Our favorite one-fourth time of the year. We are both retail investors, and we have our own investments, but we definitely like to follow the market, and we definitely follow the companies that we work with or we come to in touch with on our daily basis with marketing and prospecting and everything else. So anyways, it's interesting. We just as we start recording this is about 2 PM Pacific time, and the companies that are reporting today are reporting as we speak, including a few of them. And I was just looking at one of them. Is actually where you just came back from, Starbucks, your favorite coffee shop. So it looks like they did pretty good, no? Or how? I mean, I go there all the time, so they must be doing pretty good just because I go there.
Yeah, they actually. What was most impressive? The reason why I think their stock's up about 3-4% after hours. But the main thing that they did was they increased same store sales by 6%, which is massive. I mean.
That's just because they probably increased the prices more than the people want more coffees.
Well, I think it's a combination of things. And because what's really impressed me with Starbucks over the past couple of years is that they've managed to continue to grow. Because, I mean, same store sales, especially because Starbucks has been around for a while now and they have tens of thousands of stores. It's not easy to grow same store sales that much because you're often dealing with the same amount of people in the same area. So how you get them to keep spending more, and especially 6% more, is quite a bit. And I think the two, because really they went through a bit of inflection point a few years ago where I think Starbucks used to be seen as almost a luxury item, but then it became very mainstream to where I don't think anybody considers Starbucks luxury anymore. Now, it's still a...
it's a status symbol type thing.
It is and it isn't. I would say because there's more boutique coffee shops now that I think would be more. But I think the biggest thing that they've done is actually through their app. Their app has continued to gain millions of downloads, and they did a major overhaul of their app earlier this year, and they have a fantastic reward system. They have really good notifications. Overall, they're just finally kind of catching up with that technology that really has allowed them to grow their sales and increase the revenue from their loyal customers.
But let me ask you one thing. I'm not sure you had a chance. This is just almost like live as we speak. But did you see if the revenue or per store revenue increase was mostly in U.S. Stores or it was mostly China or overseas? Because I know they have a big expansion plan for China, and that was one of their hopes.
But the big thing was the same store sales, not the expansion. Expansion is one thing, and yes, they're still trying to expand, but it was their existing U.S. stores that have been around for decades.
Okay, so existing U.S. versus existing overseas.
I believe it was company-wide, so I don't know the full breakdown. But basically, they grew the same store from last year, made 6% more this year, which is quite a jump considering, like I said, these stores are, many of them are 10, 20 years old. So it's not like they're new. It's hard to keep growing the revenues of the same locations, but they've been successful in doing so. And that's why the stock has, I mean, really roared over the past year or so, because they've been very successful.
Yeah, I mean, there was a big question mark when Howard Schultz retired from being CEO, and they didn't know exactly how much the leadership was going to be affected, you know, or affecting Starbucks revenues overall. But it seems like he's recovered without a glitch, basically.
I think the two major things is that they've doubled down on the experience of being in a Starbucks and really people using it as the... It's what you call kind of the third space. Everyone has their home and then their office. But then, I mean, obviously some people use Starbucks as their office, but it's the third space that everyone needs. And in some cases that could be a park, it could be a mall, it could be whatever. But more and more it seems like coffee shops and obviously Starbucks itself are becoming that third space. And they've been very successful. And then on top of that, with the app, building loyal customers, they have constant rewards and all these things for shopping more frequently with them. And yeah, I think they've been doing a great job. So I've been impressed with them.
Yeah, I was actually, as you were talking, I was looking at some live results right now on a couple of finance websites. And actually, Starbucks is now at an all-time high. So that's actually pretty remarkable, you know, considering how long it's been in business and the ups and downs that they've had, and the fact that they are now an all-time high at this time or at this stage of their growth is actually.
And they continue to grow while being very profitable, which is obviously the most difficult thing to do, but they've been successful.
Well, they are a very the margins of Starbucks are one of the highest. Obviously, the fact that you can buy a coffee there for $4 versus $1 somewhere else. I mean, that tells you that exactly. It's all the experience that you're paying for.
They have lots of competition from McDonald's and Burger King. Like Burger King, I believe, had a thing where it was like 50 cents for a coffee. Mm-hmm. Something, mm-hmm. You know, so lots of pressure on the price. But they've actually been able to continue to increase prices without losing their customer
base. And the good thing, one thing I like about Starbucks too, is they have good employee benefits too. I mean, the guys there, they seem pretty happy. I mean, there are always younger students and things like that, but most of them are pretty happy working there. They get good benefits. Some of them, they get this student aid and scholarships and things like that. So medical benefits as well. So it's a company that a lot of people would like to work for.
Well, they can afford to do that because of their margins. That's the thing. And they've realized that the Starbucks customer doesn't buy a Starbucks because they're looking for a quick caffeine boost. If you're looking for a quick caffeine boost, there's a million cheap options for that. Yeah. The Starbucks customer is looking for the experience, and that's what they provide. That's why the price competition from a $1 coffee at McDonald's has not affected them at all.
Really. And I'll tell you one thing. I mean, obviously, for American consumers, regardless of income level, they go to Starbucks, buy a coffee, you know, this coffee, that coffee. But when you travel and you go to most European countries or any other countries where Starbucks is present, people also buy coffee there. It's like a status quo, like a symbol of going there. You know, like I said last week, I was in Spain.
Yeah, even
a couple of weeks ago on the Starbucks store, which is quite a few. I mean, over there in Madrid specifically, they were actually pretty full.
Even in other countries like Spain, France, other countries that are known for their own artisanal coffee, they've still been able to be successful. Obviously, Italy is really the only one that they haven't penetrated in, but
I thought they actually opened the first store there.
But it's not nationwide.
Okay.
But really, countries like Spain, France, Germany, maybe Germany not as much as are known for their coffee, but especially Spain and France.
The UK as well.
The UK, which is very much a tea country. They've been able to penetrate there despite what you might consider boundaries. So overall, Starbucks keeps being successful. We'll see if they're able to maintain the growth. Well, I don't know if I'm a buyer. I mean, they're at all-time highs, but
I don't
give investment advice. I just tell you what companies are doing and people can decide on their own.
I actually, full disclosure, I used to own Starbucks. I don't own it right now, but I used to. And I sold it. I made enough money. I sold it. You know, it's one of those things that I decided my target selling price, and I did, and I was happy when I did it. And obviously, you could say I could have kept it, whatever, but it doesn't matter. It is what it is. So,
who's next?
All right. So, this is a company that I'm not very familiar with, but you are. It's Snap.
Okay.
And obviously, parent company of Snapchat, which went public about a year ago, 2 years ago, I think, or maybe more. It's been kind of quick. It's been a while.
Two and a half. I think it was winter 2017.
It's being kind of nicknamed the testing ground for Facebook and Instagram, since everything that they try, then if it works, Facebook will copy it. If it doesn't, then Snapchat takes the losses.
So Snapchat finally reached, or I should say re-reached their IPO price.
Yeah, exactly.
And really, I've been kind of skeptical of Snapchat myself, the app, because before, they were the dominant app for the, I would say, you know, ages 13 to 25 generation, the Gen X, I guess you could call it, and a lot of millennials. But after Instagram Stories copied Snapchat Stories, a lot of people moved over to Instagram, and that still continues to be the case. But where Snapchat and Snapchat Story usage, you can look at the data, the numbers show that Stories usage is just down a lot on Snapchat. But where they still do continue to succeed, and they finally passed the 200 million user mark, monthly active user mark, is in the messaging side. Mm-hmm. They still have a great messaging platform, and Facebook has not quite been able to replicate that yet because it's unique in Instagram itself has tried the disappearing messages, but that never really took off. And now Facebook is, with their new kind of chat app that they were that Mark Zuckerberg discussed a few months ago that was going to combine Instagram, Facebook, and WhatsApp. We'll see what happens with that. But so far, the thing that has not been able to be replicated is the chat part, and that's where they've been able to be successful, and they still have over 200 million users now. So they're not dead yet. They are they're still on a growth path, but I think really they're going to have to find... The problem with chat is, as you know, obviously we've seen with WhatsApp, it's really hard to monetize a messaging app. WhatsApp hasn't been monetized yet, and it's, I don't know, what, 7 years old now or so?
Oh,
I mean,
at least.
2012 or maybe more. Earlier. Anyways, it's maybe almost a decade old, and they still haven't monetized
it. So obviously Snapchat must be selling ad space to have revenue. So.
They do. They sell it on the stories side. But as I said, they're not growing in stories. In fact, they're shrinking as far as stories usage, because the people who use stories have really migrated over to Instagram. And that's where, and we'll talk about Facebook later, but a lot of, if you look at their, and even Sheryl Sandberg and Facebook themselves have said that the future of Facebook's ad growth is actually going to be through stories, not so much through the timeline. But
stories and groups, they said the same thing.
Yeah, but especially on Instagram, if you look at the, and we work obviously in the ad space, if you look at the amount of ad buy, just, I mean, I remember last summer, we were really figuring out how to run Instagram stories ads because it was relatively new. And now just a year later, if you're not running Instagram stories, you're missing out majorly as far as basically... ROAS on Instagram. Mm-hmm. So it's become a major ad group that I don't necessarily think if you told people 2 years ago, they would have believed. But the problem is that if you look at stories compared to WhatsApp, Facebook has been throwing ads all over both Facebook stories and Instagram stories. WhatsApp really doesn't have any ads
but
yet.
With Snapchat, has the demographic group or target changed over time, or still pretty
not,
much a young?
It's still.
I
very,
mean, it used to be a teenager type platform, and I'm not sure it still is.
It's,
I mean,
still
what is the higher end of the spectrum for Snapchat?
I would probably say 30.
30.
But beyond that, I don't think there's very many users. I mean, I can look at the exact numbers, but it's basically the people who were 25-year-olds 5 years ago are now 30, and maybe they still use it, but
so what
they have
to
not
people,
been able to
they,
penetrate.
They just drop off, they move on to other platforms, so they just disappear? Or
no,
they increase the monthly active users, so either they have more...
Well, they have younger people, but they have not been able to make the leap like Instagram did, where Instagram in the beginning was only young people pretty much, but they made the leap to people in their 40s, 50s, 60s. Everybody uses Instagram now. Snapchat has yet to make that leap. And I don't know that they will, to be honest with you. I think the only way they make that leap is just that over time, their users will age up.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know that necessarily...
Retaining the older users while acquiring younger
But
users.
I don't know if they're going to go get the 50-year-old to
Maybe
start using Snapchat.
Maybe they don't even
Snapchat.
Want to. They want to have that niche.
Well, yes and no. I mean,
because
they want user
is,
growth where they can
yeah,
get
Yeah, but
it.
Facebook is becoming more of an older people type social media platform.
That's why Instagram...
Younger people fled Facebook a long time ago.
That's well known. But... Instagram is really the main platform now, and I mean, really, it wouldn't surprise me if Instagram actually became more valuable as far as valuation than Facebook itself within the next 5 years.
Well, I mean, Facebook is apparently moving towards making Instagram the old Facebook and making Facebook more of a group.
Right.
Chat exchange,
so
things like that.
We'll talk about Facebook more in a little bit because we want to talk about the antitrust stuff. But Snapchat, they're back on a growth trajectory, which is good because they stopped growing.
Well,
for
hopefully
over
this
a year.
Won't be a one-off because this is the first time they actually. I think their stock is back to 17, which is their IPO price.
Right.
So it's the first time they reached that price back again, where they'll be losing quarter after quarter. So we'll see. If this is a one-off or if it continues.
The unique thing that Snapchat has that at least is an opportunity for them to drive revenue in the short term and maybe in the long term as well is that they do have a lot of penetration with the Gen X and kind of the younger millennials and even Gen Z, that's even the younger generation. Is that the youngest?
I'm sorry. Running out of letters.
Gen X is
and
older.
Gen Y.
I meant Gen Y is millennial. Gen Z is what I meant, not Gen X. Sorry. Mm-hmm. It's hard to keep track of these things.
X, Y, Z.
Anyways, basically, the under 25s, they have a lot of penetration and a lot of ad space to be sold. So for advertisers, if you have a product that's targeting younger people, it's a great opportunity. The ads are not that expensive. And so that could be a short term. We could see the next year, 24 months, them grow their ad revenue because just there's lots of advertisers that want to reach that audience. Mm-hmm. Now, as far as their long-term growth, we'll have to see what happens.
I'm still not convinced. If you ask me, I probably wouldn't buy it, but I'm not. I usually buy companies that I use, that I'm familiar with, that I consume, and Snap is not one of them. So, I'm not even enthused with that particular stock.
Their biggest threat, really, and we're probably going to have a future episode on this company, would be TikTok, because TikTok, for those who don't know, it's basically a Chinese company called ByteDance, which is massive in China, and they bought the app Musical.ly, which was massive with the probably 10 to 16 year old crowd. Mm-hmm. And now they've kind of morphed it into, if people remember Vine, kind of a Vine-esque app, but it's a little different. It's basically a video sharing app, and it's grown massively. It's the fastest growing app in the world right now as far as users go. And they are the biggest threat because young people are definitely using TikTok. Now, I have my qualms with TikTok, and we'll talk about that in a future episode, but that's probably the biggest threat to Snapchat right now.
All right, very good. All right, let's move on to another company that actually did very well this second quarter, and that is Intel. We have a lot of Intel people here in Phoenix. In fact, in this area where we are offices.
There's not one, but two massive
major
buildings. Right. Like it looks almost like, if people have seen the show Mr.
Like
Robot,
they even have their own street names and everything. Intel Avenue, Intel Court.
If people have seen the show Mr. Robot, and they have this like massive, I think it's E-Corp building. Mm-hmm. It looks exactly like that, and there's two of them in our area. But anyways, yes, they did well.
Is it because of Apple's
so there's,
purchase?
There's kind of two pieces of news. One, they beat earnings. I talk a lot about, or not a lot, but a decent amount about Intel and the chip space on my podcast, MGR Edge. But to give this a short story, Intel has been falling behind over the past couple of years as far as they used to always be on the forefront of the chip space. If you wanted a great chip, you bought an Intel. That has not been the case over the past 2 years. AMD has their what's called the Ryzen series, mm-hmm. and they've been able to make chips that basically beat them on all the benchmarks while also are cheaper, which means that everybody who's looking for the higher end performance has been going to AMD. I'm sorry. And they've just been falling behind. And as far as the manufacturing goes, there's Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company, which has been basically kicking their butt as far as, the big thing that all these chip manufacturers are trying to do is make smaller chips with high performance. And so right now, Intel is not able to create the 7 nanometer chips, which is the smallest. I mean, there's four, but that's farther away. So right now it's only TSMC and Samsung that are able to do that. TSMC is the leader, and really Intel has fallen very far behind. They have a 14, which is double the size, and they have a 9, but the performance is not the same. So really, not to get too technical, but basically they've not been doing as well, and they've really struggled on the manufacturing side because they're one of the few companies that designs and manufactures its own chips. AMD just designs them and then outsources the manufacturing mm-hmm. to TSMC. Mm-hmm. And so because they do both, they have more pricing power, but they also are taking the risk of falling behind in performance, which is exactly what's happened. And but this quarter, they've been getting smashed in the last few quarters, just underperforming. This mm-hmm. quarter, they were able to beat expectations. Whether they'll be able to continue that, I don't know. We'll see. They're still obviously a major player, but they've lost their dominance, basically.
Well, there were some big doubts with them when the PC business was starting to decline and people were just migrating from the traditional computer or personal computer to phones, smartphones, tablets, and things.
The two major areas of chips right now are not in the consumer computer.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's really in the cloud and server business, mm-hmm. which is where Intel is still dominant. That's where they compete the best.
On the mobile.
And mobile.
Right.
In mobile, they've completely fallen apart. And just today, they sold their mobile chip business to Apple for $1 billion. That's it. Okay. Mm. Intel is a massive multi-billion dollar company, and they sold their entire mobile wing to Apple with 2,200 employees for $1 billion. That's absolutely nothing. And it just kind of shows the failure that Intel had in the mobile space.
Well, what do you think Apple is going to do with that?
Oh, I think it's a smart move for Apple. They're
obviously at that price, but are they going to just do it for control, or they just do it because...
So there's two reasons. One, Apple just came out of the whole Qualcomm ordeal where they had these lawsuits for years. I don't want to get too into it, but basically Qualcomm wanted to take, for using their chips, they wanted to take a royalty. Basically a percentage, instead of just charging for the chips, they take a percentage of the device revenue, which Apple says is absolutely ridiculous. We're not going to give you a percentage of our, you know, $1,200 phone just because you have the patent on this certain chip. It's not the chip that makes the phone worth $1,200. The chip is used in tons of phones. It's our Apple brand and our other technology. But that was basically the case. So they sold it a few months ago, but Apple wants to get away from Qualcomm if they can and move towards basically bringing everything in-house. Now, it is a risk because, again, they could face the same that Intel is facing, where if they're designing and manufacturing everything, yes, it gives them more control over their supply chain, but they also take the risk of falling behind in hardware performance, which they already are. Apples to apples, no pun intended, their hardware performance compared to the top-of-the-line Android devices is not the same, but because they have the better software, obviously they're able to outcompete. So the only danger is they could fall behind. But for the cheap price that they bought it at, it's worth the shot. If it doesn't work, you just go back to buying other people's chips.
Very good. All right. So I was just looking now. Google, or Alphabet, the parent company, is also reporting right now. Actually, I think they just finished a few minutes ago, and they also improved over the previous quarter. I don't know if you remember, but Google actually had they had a little lapse in the first quarter, and people will say, you know, that people are used to certain companies always be like, increasing expectations, and Google Alphabet is one of those. And in the first quarter, people were kind of freaking out because they didn't meet the investors or analyst expectations, and they actually went a little lower. So, but second quarter, back to normal. They are actually an increase of 16% over the previous quarter. And
is that earnings or revenue?
Revenue increase of 16%, and mostly, guess what? It's ad sales.
Well, that I was going to ask you, what's the breakdown? Because
We don't have all the details now. They basically just reporting, and even some of the ad sales revenue is excluding what they call TAC, which is traffic acquisition cost, which is what they pay all their affiliates for their traffic and all that. But overall, they went up compared, 16%. And it seems like it's more back to normal. We've seen that ourselves. I mean, it's funny because, that's why I said that I like to invest in companies or look at companies that we work with. And we've seen the ad costs continue to increase. And we refer to this with our clients as ad inflation. I mean, if we're talking the country inflation is, I know you disagree, but it's like 2.5%, whatever. Google, or basically ad space inflation, is incredible. I mean, the cost is like, for the last 2 years or year and a half, it's been like 25% more expensive to the average cost for a banner, for ad, for space, for basically cost per click. And not only with Google, again, Facebook will come later too, but all the online marketing or digital advertising has increased the cost, and this is basically what Google is doing. One of the questions that we have, and I think we mentioned this too on our podcast, is the fact that when it used to be Google advertising, and then you have Facebook or social advertising with Facebook, Instagram, now Amazon is also becoming a major player in the advertising space. And we mentioned before that when it comes to product search, Amazon is starting to dominate. But as far as intent-based searches, people that are looking for specific topics and locations or everything, Google still dominates, and it's basically what we're seeing now.
So let me ask you this, because you're intimately involved with Google, and you have been for probably a decade now. I saw this question posed on Twitter, and I thought it was really interesting. And when you kind of think about it, it's really intriguing, because basically 90% of their revenue comes from ad sales.
Yeah.
And their profits is almost 100%. Because even though they get revenue from their Pixel phones, and it's
keep
not
in mind, when
profitable.
We say Google, it's also YouTube as well.
And it's Alphabet,
It's Alphabet, which is a brand company, but it also includes YouTube
so
advertising.
So the question that was posed was, if you separated Google's search business from everything else, and you had Google search, and then you had Google conglomerate, which was everything else, what would be the valuation? Because I think Google's valued at $800 billion. What would be the valuation of everything else?
I don't think
it would be almost nothing. I think
no, it's absolutely nothing. I mean, in fact, the other businesses are losing money. I mean,
a lot
many
of
the
yeah, they use the ad business to fund
exactly,
it.
Exactly. They have their what was they called before? It was their
they had Google X.
Google X now, but it used to be.
I think they changed it to Google. They have different wings. There's Google Ventures, which is their VC,
right?
And then they have Google X, and but anyways,
another name. Anyways, yeah, no, they have a lot of those things, and they also do a lot of acquisitions. They acquire robotic companies, they acquire AI companies, they acquire all kinds of companies just to acquire them, and then either use them, they use them. If not, they just basically
They have a massive R&D budget, one of the biggest in the world.
But no, as you said, if it weren't for the search business, which is their core business, 90% of the revenue, the rest is just basically peanuts. I mean, they are trying to be in all places, including Waymo's and things like that.
Right.
But search business is where their core.
So do you think that of all their other businesses, because obviously the other thing, major asset that they have is Android, but Android is just an open source software, and the Google Play Store is where they make the most money from that. So that's probably their largest business besides search. If there was another business that were to really take off and be a major revenue driver for them, what do you think it would be of all the
things
they have?
I think YouTube is an interesting.
Well, let's consider that part of search, because that is very.
But I don't know. Looking at search, I'm looking at now the YouTube TV and all that. So the subscription.
That's true.
The subscription portion of YouTube now could significantly add revenues to Google as well, because before it was just the ads becoming. In fact, Google Ads became it used to be Google AdWords, and it became Google Ads to basically consolidate everything. And now you can advertise on YouTube and everything with the same basically main console. So I think the YouTube TV, which they're advertising to death now, even on TV and everything else, could become a little bit of a recurring revenue, like competing with Netflix and all those as far as revenue generating. And we'll get to Netflix in a second too. But I think YouTube on its own, not just the ad revenue, but also the
YouTube
subscription, is going to be worth
conservatively probably 100 to 150
well
billion.
Yeah, if not more in the future. And keep in mind, I mean, YouTube is the number two search engine too,
right?
Which is also basically part of Google Alphabet.
Do you think at any point though that, I mean, their hardware, they kind of take the lower end route? Not that they have, I mean, their Pixels, the Pixel phone especially, has been high quality, but they still offer a much cheaper alternative than Apple and other companies.
And they did the same thing with Chromebooks and all that stuff. I mean, they always try under Google Docs and all that stuff. I mean, they try to do things that are more entry level for everybody to afford or be able to use at no cost. And they also have like very low entry level Chromebooks and the Pixel phones and so forth. And I think that's fine. But like as you said before, that's not their revenue generating business.
To me, the biggest thing that has the most potential, even though I don't know that it will actually be anywhere close to the ad business, is their enterprise side with Google Cloud and trying to compete with AWS and Microsoft, and then also their
Amazon Web Services.
Right. But they had, I'm totally blanking.
Which one?
On Google, as far as their enterprise business, I think that's the one that has the most potential to be another major source of revenue. But they have so much competition now that
it's tough.
It's difficult.
What these major companies are doing, I'm talking the Facebooks, social media, Instagram, Amazon, Google, Apple, they all try to get customers to be part of their ecosystem.
Right.
That's the main thing. That's why I think even Amazon came with their own phone. What was the name of the phone?
Fire phone.
The Fire phone, which was a Fire fiasco. Yeah. And they basically eliminated it. But the whole purpose is like they have a main revenue stream, which in Google's case is search and Amazon is sales and Facebook is social media and advertising. And then they try to come up with all these other tools where it's just trying to get people not to leave their ecosystem. Like you are there, you are in that dome that is Facebook or Amazon or whatever, and then you can do everything from there. Facebook came with their own phone too that had the home screen was basically Facebook. And so you know, Apple, the same thing. You stay with the Apple ecosystem with,
Apple's unique that they actually make more money from their hardware than their platform. All the other companies make more money from the platform than hardware.
But they're also, you know, they have their Apple Music. Obviously, they just got rid of iTunes now.
Now they're shifting more towards services.
Right.
Because obviously the hardware is capped. You know, it's going to be hard for them to sell more phones.
Exactly.
But anyways, that was just my question for you, separating the search business from everything else.
No, we know. I mean, in fact, the numbers basically show $32.6 billion in this quarter just from ad sales revenue. Yeah, so, I mean, you multiply that
biggest
times...
Biggest ad company in the world.
Right, exactly. I mean, that's a chunk of change when you're paying, you know, a dollar.
But that's why they can afford to spend so much on Waymo and buying all
these
different companies. They spend a ton of money developing, like, on their AI research. I mean, they just pour money into all of these ventures because they can afford it. But none of them have really paid off and turned into major revenue drivers. So that's my question. Will we see something? I'm sure we will, but right now it's not clear.
Right. Okay. Well, the other company I wanted to kind of discuss briefly is one that you love and we discussed many times here. Which
love
is,
their products.
Tesla. So Tesla didn't do so well. Surprise, surprise. Mr. Elon Musk missed expectations. What do you think happened to them? They reported yesterday, or it was 2 days ago?
It was yesterday.
It was yesterday, and the stock went down 13%, and it seems like people are starting to lose faith in Mr.
To me, the bigger loss actually wasn't the earnings miss. It was that their CTO stepped down.
Right.
He was one of the original people at the company. He's been there since day one, and obviously, listen,
he was a co-founder. He was he was the guy that was there from day one,
exactly.
15 years ago.
Yeah, and so he stepped down as CTO. And obviously, being a technology company, the CTO is very important as compared to maybe if a bank CTO stepped down. So I don't know exactly... Elon Musk and Tesla knew he was going to step down beforehand. How long ago he decided that he was going to, I'm not sure. But I don't know how much of an impact he had on the company as far as in the past few years. In the early days, he had a huge impact, obviously, as a co-founder. So that's the bigger loss to me. That was what the earnings, okay. Tesla is always up and down in the earnings. Some quarters they beat by a ton out of nowhere, and some quarters they miss. That's kind of the Tesla way, it almost seems. But losing such a pivotal member of the team is what worries me a little
bit. And the thing is that it's also the way they announced this people leaving, I mean, major founders leaving. I mean, Musk has this habit of just saying, oh, by the way, our CTO left and he's going to become an advisor or, you know, like he's not important, you know, like he kind of leaves the investors a little bit blindsided.
I didn't get that.
For people that actually bet on the jockey more than the horse, that's a critical person to leave.
Well, I didn't get that impression that he was saying he was unimportant. I just think he's not going to come out and say, oh my God, we're screwed, because then everybody's going to panic.
But don't you think
he doesn't want to instill worry?
Companies, anything that is a CTOMOFO.
Right, to me, because it's a CTO,
right.
The technology officer
of
a technology
company.
That
they're looking for a replacement, that this and that, and then finally you say, okay, we found a replacement, but not like, oh, by the way, he left and we have this other person stepping up and taking his job. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I think it's just the way Elon Musk runs his company, and it's fine. But I think the performance obviously is there, and it's been lacking a little bit. I mean, the output that he expected was missed, and then they lowered the prices of the Model 3. And
it's still just, at the end of the day, a production problem for them, which
exactly.
It is for everybody.
Which is critical when you are basically...
Well, it's a better problem than a demand problem. And it's always better to have too much demand than to have too little. So at least they just constantly have too much demand. And now it's funny because they're not the only ones with production problems. If you look at BMW and Ford and other companies with switching to the electric production, they've been having a lot of problems too. So it turns out, it's actually not that easy to just build a new supply line from scratch, a new production line, I should say. So, listen, at the end of the day, I think the advantage that Tesla and Elon Musk has is Elon Musk is a master fundraiser. He can get money out of anywhere.
Absolutely.
So even if the company finds itself running out of money, I think he's going to find a way to get that money and keep the company alive. That's what Elon is so good at, and I think he'll continue to. And especially because they just need to survive. I mean, it's just a survival game, because they're in the electric car space. They're the dominant player, and I think that 5-10 years from now, they will continue to be that dominant player if they can make
it. I'm not so sure about that, because I mean, they had a head start for sure. They were the first new
car
company.
They're the best selling sedan. Period.
No, obviously, yeah, they do now. But as you know, every other major manufacturer
but
is
now close.
Well, they're not close. They're getting closer.
I mean, Audi
Ford
announced
closer,
their
Audi, BMW.
Yeah,
Porsche.
But Audi announced their e-tron and did this beautiful marketing campaign and said, "Oh, it'll be available 2021."
Okay. Well, that's the same thing Tesla did. You know,
yeah,
when
but,
they were announcing
but by then
their
there will be a million plus. Well, there's already a million plus. There's going to be million Teslas on the road.
Do you think companies like Audi, Mercedes, BMW, Porsche, GM, Ford will be able to catch up faster?
No. I mean, Ford just announced last week or a couple weeks ago that they're having major production issues with their electric cars. That's what I'm saying, that it's not that easy to create, because the electric production line, you have to start from scratch. It's completely different than combustion. Mm-hmm. And so all of these companies are creating everything from scratch. They're doing what Tesla did 4 years ago. So now they have to catch up. Now, you could argue they have more experience in building production lines, but clearly it's not that easy. And that's why Audi said it's going to take them 3-4 years to build.
Well,
this.
The other factor is, as you know, Tesla is not authorized to sell through dealerships.
Well, they don't want to.
Well, they don't want to in a way, and they're also not doing it.
But they don't need to. Like I said,
they don't have a demand problem. Whenever the major manufacturers catch up and they sell their cars to dealerships.
I think dealerships are on the way out.
I don't know.
I think so. It'll be slow because they're very entrenched and they do a lot of lobbying. But I think, I'm not saying it's going to be like, oh, in 2 years they're gone. But I think over the next 10 to 20, we'll see a phasing out.
I think you always have
dealerships.
It's just that they're purchasing.
It's cutting out
procedure.
The middleman. You don't need them anymore.
Yeah.
That's why you have all of these tech companies coming up that are basically replacing
them. The reason why you have the middleman is actually goes back to legislation. And dealerships provide a lot of tax revenue to the states.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I said they have a lot of lobbying power.
Right,
but
exactly.
I think over the next 20 years, we'll see fewer dealerships.
And that's the main reason why Tesla was a lot in state by state, because they were basically complaining the dealership associations that
right,
they didn't have.
But at the end of the day, the consumer, the market always wins. And I just think that dealerships are middlemen. The only advantage that they have is the financing. But even that is, there's so many fintech options these days for automated financing. Mm-hmm. You don't need a dealership anymore.
Okay. All right, real brief. I wanted to mention quickly PayPal. PayPal is also actually went down. The second quarter came under expectations. But I know we obviously are very familiar with PayPal. Everybody uses it. It's one of the most, one of the preferred methods for payments for pretty much any e-commerce solution, whether you use Stripe or your favorite thing. I mean, PayPal is an aggregator that is one of the best out there. They came lower. They're having some product delays issues and also some currency exchange issues and things like that. I mean, it's not very clear why they're having these problems now, and they kind of lower their expectations for the next quarter until they adjust. So obviously, investors always kind of tend to overreact, and they panicked, and the stock lowered or went down a bit after their reporting. But I don't know if PayPal is going to be in trouble, to be honest.
Well,
it's very solid.
Because I've seen there's lots of new, basically, fintech startups. And I think that the major thing that PayPal will be facing pressure in is pricing pressure. I know there's a company called TransferWise, which is one of the faster growing basically payments companies, and they have significantly lower fees than PayPal.
Right. So,
do you think that they'll see a price squeeze?
Of course. There's going to be a competition, and PayPal is already considering that. I mean, they have adjustment in prices. You have an e-commerce store, depending on your volume of sales, they give you different price breaks as far as percentage. You may start with a 2.9 and then 2.4, 2.1. 1.9, you know, obviously pricing competition is going to exist no matter with.
Right, but
the convenience and the global reach of PayPal. PayPal is I know it's probably one of the few companies that is globally used, not just in the US,
but
in Europe.
My question is, they don't necessarily have anything unique as far as their product. What they have is a massive user base.
Mm-hmm.
that's why they're able to keep their prices higher as far as the fees go. But it's, but they don't have necessarily a better product than TransferWise. It's just that they're the much larger and they're older as well. PayPal is what, 20 years old now?
Well, yeah, I remember. Obviously, you know, Elon Musk. I mean, right. It was funded by them, and then it was acquired by eBay, and then split off.
But my question is, over the next, I'm not saying this is going to be instant. Like anything, it's going to take a while. But over the next 5-10 years, I think we're going to see a lot of. They're going to see a lot of competition. There's a lot of innovation in the finance space. Mm-hmm. Even with, because, you know, they own Venmo, but they don't make any money from that. That was more of a user acquisition play, but they don't make any money from Venmo. And I think that there's going to be a price squeeze in the payments space. It's going to be able to charge fewer and fewer fees. And I want to know, I want to see how PayPal navigates that going into the future.
That's always been the case. I mean, this companies, even when you go to Visa and MasterCard, I mean, those are very, very profitable companies. And I don't know if they reported yet or not, but I used to own Visa and when it went IPO, actually. And they own the space, and there's competition, but those companies are based on volume. And every time you swipe a card, in the case of the credit cards, basically it's a fee for them. It's a profit for them. So with PayPal, it's the same thing. Every time you use any type of solution, because it's convenience. Okay, you go to any online type store and you find, okay, put your credit card or pay with PayPal. And it's like, okay, I don't have my credit card. I don't want to pull it out of my wallet, this and that. Just go with PayPal. This is my username and password. Yes, click, click, click. You don't do anything. And just basically the merchant would pay for the fee, but for you, there's no extra cost. So as far as the consumer goes, it's much more convenient that you can send money to friends, you can send money to family, you can pay for the business, you can create your own invoicing and billing. So I think they have a lot of services that people are not familiar with. And they also have their own lending division, which obviously has small business lending. So I think it's just a little hiccup for them. And all this, the financing industry and the payments industry is going through a lot of regulation to avoid fraud and everything else. So they obviously need to adjust on each country, and European Union just came out with another regulation that is kicking in September. So all those things are factoring in, but really they are not just going to affect PayPal. They will affect all the payment processes.
I agree on the regulation obviously affects everybody. But my question is that there's going to be so much growing competition that I wonder, because you could say maybe they'll beat the startups because they have the network effects. That's certainly possible. But a company that I think is in great position to potentially hurt them a lot, and they're already entered the space, is Amazon. Amazon has Pay. Mm-hmm. And Amazon, if they wanted to, could maybe say, okay, we're going to have half the fees as PayPal. And they have the network effects.
Right.
What if Amazon did that? What's PayPal's answer then?
I'm sure that PayPal is looking over that already. Yeah.
So I just, because there's lots of companies coming up that I think are going to really challenge PayPal, and not just PayPal, other payments companies as well. And I'm really interested in the fintech space. It's been one of the most invested in space in the VC world for years now. So I'm really interested to see how that space evolves. Just because I think finance is one of the older industries that really hasn't had a ton of innovation. And now I think over the next decade, we're going to see that. So anyways, we don't have the answers, but we will definitely watch it.
Right. Okay. So this is getting a little longer now, but I didn't want to wrap up this podcast without discussing our major monster here, which is Facebook. And also Amazon, which are two companies that we work with on the antitrust
side.
Obviously Facebook reported revenues too, and they went
their FTC fine.
Right. Everything came to this quarter. The fine was $6
billion.
$5 billion, which was expected. And as far as Facebook revenues go, is nothing. It's just pocket change for them.
So Facebook's valued at $500 billion. So a $5 billion fine, it stings. But it's not life-changing.
And they already expected it.
In fact,
they set money aside for it.
When the fine, because the fine, there was another fine last week. Was it the same fine or was it different?
No, this is for the data protection.
So really the stock hasn't really been affected by it. And that's because it could have been much worse. Even the people at the FTC said that this was a lenient fine. And you know, the beauty is that, okay, it's $5 billion and it stings, and it's a lot of money, obviously, for anybody. But for Facebook, it's really just not that much. And now, that kind of, it's case closed, literally. They can't be fined for that again.
Well, in the U.S., Europe is a whole different story.
Yeah, that's true. But the point is that I just think that Facebook is
they call
grew
it
a lot. I mean,
they call Teflon now. They call Facebook the Teflon company. It's like no matter what happens to Facebook with all the scandals and the Cambridge Analytica and this and that and the privacy things and the videos and this and that.
The only threat.
They keep adding more users and they keep increasing the revenue.
Especially Instagram and WhatsApp continue to grow. Facebook obviously has 2.2 billion. It's going to be tough for them to continue to grow, even though they're still trying to in emerging economies, Africa and India. But obviously those places aren't going to be, the user value is not going to be as high because they just don't have as much money for spending on goods. So the ad revenue won't be as much, but they're still going to try to grow users for Facebook. But overall, they own three of the most used platforms in the world. So to knock them down, like what I was going to say is the only thing that could really take Facebook down is antitrust. And that's the big unknown. Now, if, say, who knows what's going to happen in the election next year? Say, I don't think she will be elected, but say, like, Elizabeth Warren wins. I don't think she will, but if she does, or someone else, or even if... someone who's not so antitrust heavy wins, but then Congress decides to really take action and split up, say, Facebook and Instagram or something of that nature, or the EU tries to put major pressure on them. That's the only threat that I really see. Basically, unless the government comes in and does something, I don't think anything's going to stop Facebook.
But I mean, the pro that we're discussing now is just not just for Facebook, it's also for Google. Or Alphabet.
Yeah, and Amazon.
And Amazon. So,
Amazon is one that I'm intimately familiar with because I do my Amazon weekly newsletter, which I'll plug real quick. You can go to mgredge.com/join if you want to join that. But anyways, it's a weekly Amazon newsletter about everything Amazon. And I talk about it almost every week now about the antitrust that's going on with Amazon. And the biggest thing that's happened, and this isn't necessarily, there's kind of two things that's happening to Amazon. One is on its liability side. And the other is on the antitrust side. On the liability side, they lost a few key cases in the past few months that really are going to hurt them. And I wouldn't say hurt them, but are going to hurt the sellers on the platform. And that is that now it is abundantly clear that courts are going to make Amazon liable for the products that are for the third party products that they sell. Before, Amazon was always kind of skating around so that if something happened with a third party seller's product, they kind of say, well, it's on the third party seller. And now there's been multiple cases where they've lost and had to have multi-million-dollar
settlements. It's funny because even that is part of the kind of terms and conditions that the sellers sign off on when they become Amazon sellers, saying you are responsible for the safety of your own products or anything else.
It makes sense. Obviously,
and
Amazon,
the court said, no, Amazon are still responsible.
They're a marketplace, they're a platform, and they have millions of 2 million sellers. So it's incredibly difficult to keep track of everything. But now, because they are basically being held liable, they lost a case in Tennessee where they're going to owe, I think, $2 million because one of those hoverboards burned down a house and they couldn't even, it was from some Chinese seller. They could never track them down. Person disappeared.
Was it the battery?
It was the battery.
Okay.
And then another case in Ohio, they lost that held them liable for something else. So basically, they're saying, I don't care if about the third-party sellers, you, Amazon, are now being held liable. And because that's the case, Amazon is just going to have to start cracking down on sellers, which is unfortunate.
We've seen it already. It's much more difficult to pass all the tests to become
a seller. I anticipate it's going to be even more so. That's the downside. So really, these things end up hurting sellers more in
the
end.
But that's more on the lawsuit type side, but as far as the antitrust, I think Amazon is not just the seller and basically putting any other big box retailer in either out of business or in dire straits. It's also the fact that they also own Amazon Web Services, which hosts all major platforms.
The biggest thing that they have, and so I wrote in the newsletter that went out earlier this week, that it's Amazon, things are kind of coming down from all sides right now, because they had last week they were on Capitol Hill testifying in front of Congress, and then this week the EU launched a probe into them basically, and they were actually looking at the biggest, because the thing with Amazon is that at the end of the day they're a great consumer product, so it's hard to say that they're traditionally antitrust is saying, oh, you have a monopoly and you're gouging people with prices, mm-hmm. like we've seen with oil, other things. But Amazon definitely does not gouge with prices. They have the lowest prices. And so they're not taking advantage of the consumer necessarily. It's actually more taking advantage of other businesses. And the biggest way that they do that is... which is what the EU is investigating, that they have all of the consumer data. And so what they do is find the best-selling products on Amazon on their own platform and then basically copy them, make their own, and instead of having to pay ads to be on the first page like everybody else, they just put themselves on the first page. And they make almost 40% of their revenue now actually comes from their own brands. And people don't realize, mm-hmm. they actually own over a dozen brands.
They do.
If you ever see Solimo or Good Threads, I think is what another one. Like all these brands, before it was just Amazon Basics. But now they have
look at,
all these
just look
brands.
At the footer of the Amazon.com website and you'll see from Zappos to Audible to this, to that. I mean, they own a bunch of brands.
Right, and those are third-party sites.
And those are third-party brands.
But I'm talking about actually on Amazon.
Yeah, Amazon
a
brands.
Lot of the brands, mm-hmm. they don't label it as Amazon, but it is. But the big difference is they don't have to pay to be on the first page. And because that, you know, when you're a seller on Amazon, you always have to account for the ad costs. But because they don't have ad costs, they can undercut the competition. And they're basically taking advantage.
And their own sellers.
Right. They're taking advantage. And mm-hmm. so that's what the EU is looking at. And that's the biggest case against them for antitrust. But as far as taking advantage of the consumer, they don't. So that's why I think Amazon is somewhat safe. I think the companies that could be more in trouble are Google and Facebook when it comes to antitrust. Because it's almost like you would never allow Facebook. Hindsight is 2020. Instagram had 10 million users when Facebook bought them. But you would never allow now if Instagram and Facebook were separate companies for them to merge. That would never mm-hmm. be allowed. And so the question is, should they be split up? And that's the question that basically the legislators are going to have to answer. The other question is, are they tech savvy enough to understand all the implications
of
these
things?
Well,
they're getting there. I mean, the Congress knows that they cannot have a 80-year-old congressman asking questions to Mark Zuckerberg. They're getting there. And frankly... Honestly, I mean, they may not be able to know all the intricacies of Facebook or Google to just decide you guys have too much power, too much data, and you need to come up with a solution or we're going to do it for you, you know. So we'll see. That's going to be interesting. Any other topics you'd like to discuss? Preview of your podcast. What are you doing this week?
I will be talking about Facebook, but I'll actually be talking about Facebook's Libra coin.
Cryptocurrency.
I have an interesting theory. I previewed it on my last podcast last week as to what Facebook's goals and ambitions are with Libra.
But isn't that amazing? With everything that is going on through Facebook and everything now, that they still decide, oh, we're going to put out a cryptocurrency now. It's going to be Libra. It's like, you guys don't have enough things to be worried about and just bring one more to the market.
I think that really proves the point that they're a juggernaut. They really are unstoppable. Zuckerberg... You can call Zuckerberg a lot of things, but you cannot say that he's not a executioner when it comes
like
to business.
Give the press just one more thing to say, oh, now you're going to basically take payments via cryptocurrency with your own currency and then just keep everything within your ecosystem like we were talking about. Now you even have your own currency. So anyways, I don't know much about Libra, so I can't really give my opinion. I've read a little bit, like everybody, like headlines. But
you can tune in tomorrow and learn all about it.
Okay, we'll do that. All right, well, this is it for today. Thank you for listening to MGR Unplugged, and we'll be back again next week. I really don't know. I have a couple of guests that I have semi-confirmed. I don't know which one will come first. There are two young people in different fields of expertise, but we'll announce them next week. So until then, have a great day and weekend, and we'll see you soon. Bye, everybody.